Madam Secretary, before we broke, there was a question asked that I thought was a fair question, which is, why was I talking about Mr. Blumenthal's emails? I do think that's a fair question. I think it's an equally fair question to ask why you were reading Mr. Blumenthal's emails. I think both are fair, so I want to go to June of 2012, which is an interesting time period to look at. It started. Charlene Lamb was an employee of the State Department, and she sent an email which you may be familiar with. It's at tab 56. I'm not going to read it, but it's at tab 56, where she described Benghazi as a soft target, attacks on Americans not staffed adequately. It's a very haunting email to read. It was actually 3 months to the day when our four fellow citizens were killed, and that's on June the 7th, 2012. Also on June the 7th of 2012, your Deputy Chief of Staff, Mr. Jake Sullivan, is emailing Ambassador Stevens, asking the ambassador to look at a memo Sidney Blumenthal sent you. And in fact, Mr. Sullivan writes to the ambassador, Chris, checking in with you on this report, any reactions? All right, that's on exactly the same day that I believe our ambassador's papers were accepted in Libya. It's the day after an IED attack on our compound, and Chris Stevens is being asked to read and react to an email by Sidney Blumenthal from your deputy chief of staff. And this is what he's writing on the 7th. This is after he's been turned down on a request for more security. This is our ambassador. Appreciate you giving this proposal consideration, even if the conclusion was not favorable for us. We'd be interested in pursuing the other avenue you suggest, high-threat trained agents. Best, Chris. So I've got this contrast in my mind. An ambassador is newly in place. It's a day after an attack on our facility. Your deputy chief of staff is sending him an email from Sidney Blumenthal asking him to take time and react to it. And then, to the best of my recollection, that's forwarded to you. So help us understand how Sidney Blumenthal had that kind of access to you, Madam Secretary, but the ambassador did not.
Mr. Chairman, because I think that your question does help to clarify matters. Chris Stevens emailed regularly with Jake Sullivan, one of my closest aides in the State Department. He could have emailed to Mr. Sullivan, knowing that it would have been immediately responded to on any issue that was of concern to him, and he did not raise issues about security on that day or other days. And I think it's important to recognize that when an ambassador is at post overseas, especially one as experienced a diplomat as Chris Stevens, he knows where to pull the levers, where to go for information, where to register concerns. And I think he did exactly as one might have expected. He dealt with security issues through dealing with the security professionals who were the ones making the assessments. And I think that Ambassador Stevens understood completely that that's where the experts were, and that's where anything he requested or anything he was questioning should be directed.
Speaking of experts, who is Victoria Nuland?
A very experienced diplomat. She served as our ambassador to NATO, appointed by President George W. Bush. She served as one of the advisors as a Foreign Service officer delegated to the White House for Vice President Cheney. She served as the for the State Department during my tenure, and she is currently the Assistant Secretary for Europe under Secretary Kerry.
She wrote this to the ambassador on June the 13th, 2012. That is a week after the facility was attacked. It is only a handful of days after he was turned down on a request, specific request, for more security Chris, I know you have your hands full, but we'd like your advice about public messaging on the spate of violence in Libya over the past 10 days. So she's asking him for help with public messaging. Jake Sullivan, which is the other half of the question that I don't think we got to. I understand that Chris Stevens was a rule follower. I understand that. I've got no qualms. My question was actually not why Chris Stevens didn't contact you, but why did Jake Sullivan send Chris Stevens a Sidney Blumenthal email to read and react to on the day after the facility was attacked, the same day he was denied a request for more security, and instead of email traffic back and forth about security, it's read and react to a Blumenthal email?
Well, I think any ambassador, if one were sitting before the committee, would say that they handled a lot of incoming information and requests. Some of it was about what was happening in country. Some of it was about what was happening back in the United States. And Chris felt strongly that the United States needed to remain in and committed to Libya. So he was concerned that there might be a feeling on the part of some, either in the State Department or elsewhere in the government, that we shouldn't be in Libya. And he was adamantly in favor of us staying in Libya. So part of what the discussion with him and Jake Sullivan and others was, you know, how do we best convince the stakes the United States has in staying involved in Libya would be? And I thought that was, very much in keeping with both his assessment and his experience.
Well, I appreciate your perspective, Madam Secretary. Let me share with you my perspective. And if you need to take a time to read a note, I'm happy to pause.
No, I'm just being reminded, which I think is important, that, remember, Chris spent the vast majority of his time in Tripoli, not in Benghazi. So a lot of what he was looking at is how you deal with not only those in authority positions in Libya who were based in Tripoli at that time, but also representatives of other governments and the like. And I think it is fair to say that any time you're trying to figure out what's the best argument to make, especially if you're someone like Chris Stevens trying to put together and make the best argument about why the United States should remain committed to Libya and others as well, he's going to engage in conversations about that.
Well, with respect, Madam Secretary, no matter what city he was in Libya, having to stop and provide public messaging advice to your press shop and having to read and respond to an email sent by Sidney Blumenthal, it doesn't matter what town you're in. He needed security help. He didn't need help messaging the violence. He needed help actually with the violence. Have said several times this morning that you had people and processes in place. I want to ask you about an email that was sent to you by another one of your aides, Ms. Uma Abedin. That would be exhibit number 70 in your folder. She emailed you that the Libyan people needed medicine, gasoline, diesel, and milk. Do you know how long it took you to respond to that email?
Well, I responded to it very quickly.
4 minutes. My question, and I think it's a fair one, is the Libyan people had their needs responded to directly by you in 4 minutes, and there is no record of our security folks ever even making it to your inbox. So if you had people and processes in place for security, did you not also have people and processes in place for medicine, gasoline, diesel, milk?
You know, Mr. Chairman, I've said it before. I will say it again. I'll say it as many times as is necessary to respond. Chris Stevens communicated regularly with the members of my staff. He did not raise security with the members of my staff. I communicated with him about certain issues. He did not raise security with me. He raised security with the security professionals. Now, I know that's not the answer you want to hear because it's being asked in many different ways by committee members. But those are the facts, Mr. Chairman.
No.
Ambassadors in the field are engaged in many different tasks. They are basically our chief representative of the President of the United States. So they deal with everything from, you know, foreign aid to security to dealing with the personal requests for visas that come from people in the country they are assigned to. And Chris Stevens had regular contact with members of my staff, and he did not raise security issues. Now, some of it may have been because, despite what was implied earlier, there was a good back and forth about security, and many of the requests that came from Embassy Tripoli, both for Tripoli and for Benghazi, were acted on affirmatively. Others were not. That is what an ambassador, especially a diplomat as experienced as Chris Stevens, would expect, that it would be unlikely to be able to get every one of your requests immediately answered positively. So, yes, he had regular contact with my aides. He did not raise security with me, and the security questions and requests were handled by the security professionals.
Madam Secretary, with all due respect, those are two separate issues. Who Chris Stevens had access to is one issue. Who had access to you and for what is another issue, because you have said you had people and processes in place. You also have people and processes in place for people who want to send you meaningless political advice. You also have people and processes in place for people who want to inquire about milk and diesel fuel and gasoline. You also have people and processes in place for people who want to provide insults towards folks you work with in the administration. All of that made it directly into your inbox, Madam Secretary. That is my question. My question is, how did you decide when to invoke a people in process and who just got to come straight to you? Because it looked like certain things got straight to your inbox and the request for more security did not. And while you're answering that, I want to inform and instruct why I'm asking it. You have mentioned the ARB on a number of occasions again today. This was not the first ARB. We had one after Kenya and Tanzania. And that ARB could not have been more specific. The Secretary of State should personally review the security situation of our embassy facilities. That ARB put the responsibility squarely on you. So with respect to that previous ARB recommendation, and in contrast, what did make your inbox versus what did not, did you personally review our security situation as the previous ARB required?
Well, let me see if I can answer the many parts of your question, Mr. Chairman. Yes, personal email came to my personal account. Work-related email did as well. And I also relied on a number of my aides and staff members, as well as experienced Foreign Service officers and civil servants, who were similarly engaged in gathering information and sharing it. And as I said, and I will repeat, Chris Stevens communicated with a number of people that I worked with on a daily basis in the State Department. So far as I know, he did not raise any issue of security with any of those people. He raised it where he knew it would be properly addressed. If he had raised it with me, I would be here telling you he had. He did not. And so I think it's important to try to separate out the various elements of your question, Mr. Chairman, and I will do my best to continue to try to answer your questions. But I have said before, and I will repeat again, Sid Blumenthal was not my advisor, official or unofficial, about Libya. He was not involved in any of the meetings, conversations, other efforts to obtain information in order to act on it. On occasion, I did forward what he sent me to make sure that it was in the mix. So if it was useful, it could be put to use. And I believe in response to the email you pointed out originally from Ambassador Stevens, he actually said it rang true and it was worth looking into. So I think it's important that we point out the fact that Mr. Blumenthal was not my advisor. He was not an official of the United States government. He was not passing on official information. He, like a number of my friends who would hand me a newspaper article, would buttonhole me at a reception and say, what about this or what about that? We're trying to be helpful. Some of it was, a lot of it wasn't.
Chair will now recognize the gentlelady from California, Ms. Sanchez.